Morning without any power. First, though, we have to get you caught up on weather around here. Guy, you're tracking rain that's on the way out this morning.
Yeah, rain exiting. So dry conditions today, dark and early still. Current time now 6 this morning. You'll notice some low clouds out there. Cloudy skies, 61. Winds a little breezy. Look at this. West northwest, 13 miles per hour. School day forecasts. Happy Tuesday. Clouds to start. Temps in the upper 60s by lunchtime with winds northwest at about 12 miles per hour. So you'll notice the breezy conditions. Most of our sunshine comes later this afternoon. I'll have the 7-day forecast. Plus, Twins have a doubleheader today. I'll have that Twins game day forecast coming up.
All right, traffic alert here in the Albertville area. This is 94 eastbound with this backup. This is just right past, right in the area of the Albertville outlet malls. There's a crash up ahead, 94 eastbound. I'm still working to find out exactly where that crash is, if it's on the shoulder of the road right now or directly on the interstate there. But regardless, as you can see, causing that backup, again, that's 94 eastbound this morning, Albertville, right in the area of the outlet malls.
Happening today, they're accused of violating the civil rights of the man whose death sparked protests around the world.
And now the four ex-Minneapolis police officers will face a judge in a federal court today for what they did and didn't do during George Floyd's death. Cece has been going over the court documents for us. Cece, what's expected to happen today?
Well, at these hearings, defendants get charges read to them. Prosecutors and attorneys can also argue several motions. One big sticking point is whether the four ex-officers will have joint or separate trials. Attorneys for Alexander King, Tu Tao, and Thomas Lane say their clients would be unfairly judged if they went to trial alongside Derek Chauvin. King's attorney mentioned that evidence against Chauvin would confuse the jury. Plus, there's a conflict of interest since Chauvin has already been convicted on state murder charges. Meanwhile, Tu Tao's attorney wants him tried apart from his co-defendants and Chauvin. Back to that federal indictment. It alleges that Chauvin used unreasonable force by kneeling on George Floyd's neck. It also says Tu Tao and Alexander King failed to intervene to stop him, and that all four officers willfully failed to help Floyd, resulting in his death. The lawyer for George Floyd's family, Ben Crump, says these charges could mark a new era in policing.
These charges that were brought by the Justice Department encourages future generations to know that our Department of Justice will be here to make sure that all of American citizens are afforded the constitutional rights of life and liberty and equal justice.
This morning's hearing will start at 10 a.m.
Yeah, another high-profile trial in Minneapolis. Thank you, Cece.
Well, Derek Chauvin is also charged in a second indictment. It stems from a 2017 arrest and neck restraint of a 14-year-old boy. He'll be in court Thursday on those charges.
Chauvin is already serving a 22-and-a-half-year sentence for George Floyd's murder. The trial for the other three officers involved in George Floyd's death is scheduled for next March. J. Alexander King, Tu Tao, and Thomas Lane are charged with aiding and abetting second-degree murder and manslaughter.
Happening right now, a desperate search in Eden Prairie. Police say this man, Mike Elhard, went on a run yesterday morning and never returned. He was last seen near Pioneer Trail and Franlow Road. If you know where he is, give Eden Prairie Police a call right away.
In our Sunrise Live, breaking overnight, Hurricane Nicholas just made landfall in Texas. This is a live look at Houston, getting pummeled by rain there. It's actually looking a little bit better here this hour than compared to the look just an hour ago. Regardless, the storm strengthened to category one hurricane overnight before making landfall along the Texas Gulf Coast. The storm has 75 mile per hour winds and is threatening the region with heavy rain and flooding. And this morning, we're getting an early look at what this storm is doing to Texas. So look at this video from our sister station in Houston. Blackout conditions in Galveston from the wind and the rain. And another look at this storm as it made its way onshore in Galveston this morning. There is a threat of flash flooding in some areas there in Texas along the Gulf Coast. And here's an area with power outages from the storm as that rain and wind continues to sweep through. At last check, our sister station at KHOU was reporting more than 200,000 customers are without power. The storm's expected to weaken now that it's made landfall, but the threat of wind and rain will continue. We're going to toss things over to Guy, who's following where this storm is heading next.
Yeah, and you can see the outer bands here continuing to pump up that rain. So flooding still, again, being that primary impact along with the winds. Still a strong tropical storm as we speak with winds at 70 miles per hour. It did make landfall again as a Category 1 with 75 miles per hour. So it just made it into a Category 1 hurricane. Now winds again, now 70 miles per hour, making it a strong tropical storm. You could still obviously see hurricane wind gusts with this storm as it continues to track off to the north northeast at 9 miles per hour. So it is a slow mover. That means it's going to dump lots of rain, significant amounts of rain as it continues to move to the north northeast. You'll see only by tomorrow morning here winds at about 35 miles per hour, but not making that much progress for where it is right now. You can see those contours indicating some areas up to 15 or more inches of rain and eventually tracking along the coast of Louisiana as well. So New Orleans still can see a lot of rain there, still maintaining its pressure at 994 millibars.
Now here's a look at today's other top stories in your morning rush. A quadruple homicide in rural Wisconsin is leading police to Minnesota. Investigators in Dunn County say four bodies were found in an SUV with Minnesota plates in a field in Sheridan. That's a town about an hour and 20 minutes east of the Twin Cities. They say there's no apparent danger to the public. If you have any information, contact Dunn County Police.
The St. Paul Fire Department is proposing a new program in this budget cycle that would spend $600,000 on a social worker response program. Social workers would be embedded with the fire department and could also be utilized by police and other services to help with homelessness and mental health calls. But at least one council member has some concerns about how it might work, that there aren't enough details in the proposal yet, and that the county should be responsible for mental health. The budget will be voted on later this year.
It's election day here in California, and last night the President of the United States, Joe Biden, campaigned right here in Long Beach on behalf of California Governor Gavin Newsom. He's on the ropes and he's fighting for his political life in what he calls an undemocratic Republican recall. The president wants everyone to know, and wanted everyone to know here last night, that the way Governor Newsom is handling these crises, including COVID, is a model he sees for the nation.
Olympic gold medalist Gable Stevenson is making money moves this wrestling season. He'll compete with the Gophers and become the first ever to have a nil deal with the WWE. That means the WWE can use his name, image, and likeness to promote him, which is a first for the company. And that's your Tuesday Morning Rush.
Guy, what's our one thing weather today?
Yeah, I got your game day forecast heading to the Twins game. It's a doubleheader today. 210 is the first game. 640 will be the second. 71 degrees by 4 o'clock. 5 o'clock, we'll see most of our sunshine. Temps in the low 70s.
All right, checking in on that traffic alert in Albertville, 94 eastbound. You can see flashing lights here in that middle chute lane. There's a crash there, MnDOT's reporting. Slowing things 94 eastbound quite a bit, though things are flowing now in this area. So something to watch out for if you're taking 94 eastbound right by the outlet mall in Albertville.
All right, Jen, thank you. Tonight, the Care 11 investigative team is launching a new series exposing how our state is failing to care for those battling mental illness and, as a result, putting the public at risk. Here's AJ Legault with a preview of The Gap, a failure to treat, a failure to protect.
Send as many ambulances as you can.
Earlier this year, a small Minnesota community was the scene of a horrific act of violence. The mass shooting and bombing at the Buffalo Medical Clinic that ended a young woman's life.
I had to tell my kids that mommy's not coming home.
In the wake of that attack, Care 11 investigates began digging into fatal flaws and cracks in Minnesota's legal and mental health systems. What we found?
That's amazing to me.
Has a state senator already calling a hearing tomorrow.
There are cases after cases after cases of people who have been in this gap, in limbo, in the Swiss cheese system, where they've gone off and murdered somebody.
Tonight at 10, Care 11 investigates The Gap, a failure to treat, a failure to protect.
With crisis after crisis, Red Cross volunteers are ready to move in and help. Later, an eye-opening firsthand account of what they're seeing at disaster sites and now how you can help here in Minnesota.
And following a summer of drama, Jeopardy is back with some new faces and one person in particular fans never expected to see.
And a lot goes into finding the right backpack. Coming up at 6:15, we'll tell you what you need to look for.
And it is a cornerstone of our diet in the U.S., but where does the food pyramid come from? Let's verify.
This viral TikTok video claims to share the origin story of the food pyramid created by the USDA in 1992.
This is how we ended up with the absolutely atrocious food pyramid. Just like just about everything else in the US, it all started with World War II.
The history she gives is mostly true, but needs some context, so we went to these sources to clarify. A food guide is a visual representation that provides guidance about how we should eat. According to the USDA, they've been giving food guidance since the 1840s, but their first visual representation of a food guide was released in 1943. It's called the Basic Seven. According to the USDA, the Basic Seven was created during World War II as a way to help people cope with limited supplies of certain foods during the war. But doctors Linsenmeyer and Nessel believe it was also created in response to widespread poverty and malnutrition that occurred a decade earlier because of the Great Depression.
This became incredibly obvious during the Second World War, when the army had a great deal of difficulty recruiting conscripts because they were so poorly nourished.
So the TikToker was correct. The 1992 food pyramid is an iteration of the USDA's first visual food guide, which was released during World War II. With your fast fact, I'm Ariane Day Till.